you know, I started off trying to follow my, you know, my dreams and follow my passions, and landscape photography was really where it started. And it was like looking at that kind of pristine landscape, a la kind of Edward Weston and Ansel Adams, and but doing it in color and large format and trying to bring color to it. At that time, there was really only one photographer, art photographer, who was doing it. Elliot Porter was the only colorist I'd seen, you know, who was trying to address the landscape with color. Because at that time, in the mid 70s, it was considered a commercial medium, and artists used black and white and did street photography. But I started kind of with that. But then, after years of kind of working with that, I started to realize that, you know, that that landscape, the pristine landscape, has kind of had lost its kind of, I think, ability. It's moved, it moved into kind of cliche and genre almost. And then, whereas the what I started to look at, the man-altered landscape, it started to appear to me that that was more of a contemporary view of my time. That the effect of what photography can do. I mean, that pristine Ansel Adams photography, and before that Carlton Watkins, was what Congress in America was looking at when they created the national park system. So it had a power. It had a narrative within their evolution and the creation of these amazing parks that preserve that beauty. But what I started looking at is that, you know, that's something that a photography, you can photograph any, you know, beautiful landscape, and it's at this point, and it's not going to have any effect. It's not going to make the change. But showing the landscape that we change became far more, I think, compelling for me. When I was born in 1955, there were 2.5 billion people on the planet, and almost every decade has brought another billion people. So I started recognizing that, you know, that's almost like 100 million people, new citizens a year. So I recognized that we're in this explosive human growth. It's kind of like a story that's unfolding that is beyond comprehension, that we're like this runaway species. And that by photographing these large examples of our reaching into nature, into the landscape, to provide for this ever-expanding population, would be a subject that would continually be evolving, continually be multiplying outwards, and that to me it was kind of like a planetary drama that's unfolding that I was interested in. That I thought if I just started chronicling the largest examples of how we remove copper from the ground and iron ore from the ground, and how we get, you know, our stone from quarries, and, you know, all these places that we you know, go to nature to get what we need, and to chronicle all these, you know, large examples of this relationship between man and nature, and how we take from nature. We need to take from nature to provide for all the things we have in the city. Everything comes from nature. It's the only, you know, as do we, you know. So to me, it was a big idea that I felt I could easily spend the rest of my life doing. You know, I think some of the work from the shipbreaking series was a very powerful series, and I was really taken by that place, by what I was able to kind of witness, to bear witness to, and you know, there's a few images out of that. There's a diptych and a few other ones out of that series that, you know, when I was photographing it, I was saying to myself, my God, you know, where do I go from here? You know, even I was kind of like, I was both ecstatic and like dread about how am I going to get past this? This is something that a subject that I recognized immediately, the power of that subject, you know, while even photographing it, knowing that when I bring these back, people are going to look at them. And I think that was... That marked also the beginning of my international career. That's when I started being noticed internationally for that body of work. And I think that body of work actually made changes to how ships are broken, and brought all of those questions, you know, the first world, you know, taking their largest vessels that moved their oil around for 40 years or something, and then just dumping it on the shores of Bangladesh and having people with cutting torches, you know, blowing up tanks and dying. And it was like, I think at the time there was like, they figured there was about 700 casualties a year in those yards. Just people getting blown up, people falling, things falling on them. That's not including the cut, scrapes, arms lost, and all that stuff. That's just death. So it was kind of like having the opportunity to be Charles Dickens and looking at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, where life was cheap and the satanic mills were indeed satanic mills, you know. And it was kind of like looking at the satanic mills of here and now in the present. It really started kind of innocently back in 2000, the year 2000. I started a company called Toronto Image Works, and it was a darkroom rental place. And I just got back from Bangladesh, the shipbreaking work, and the contacts were coming off the processor. And another one of my customers who was trying to get into documentary filmmakers saw these and said, "Wow, these are amazing. Where was that?" And I said, "Bangladesh." She says, "Are you thinking of going back?" And I said, "Yeah, I actually am, because I kind of got ill halfway through the shoot, and I lost half the time that I was there. And I think that there's more there for me to get." And he says, "Can I come? I bring my video camera." And so he started following me around. And so in Manufactured Landscapes, that's all the black and white footage that appears in that movie is his footage, which is about 12 minutes of that film. As it turns out, he couldn't quite get it together and make the film that I was hoping that could be made. And then Jennifer saw it. And she was at a point where, you know, she was trying to find something that she could do that wouldn't mean that she'd have to leave, because she just had a small 2-year-old at that time. So she was trying to find a project that might allow her just to stay in the editing room and do something. But she saw the footage that he had shot, and there wasn't enough to make a film out of it. So she says, "I need to do a shoot. I need to go somewhere with you." Like, and I said, "I'm still going to China." She says, "Great, we'll go to China." So that's how we started working, and we wanted to collaborate to try and make the film less of a, you know, follow the artist around, but more of a piece that stands on its own, like the images stand on their own. That it's a, that yes, it still shows me at work, and that this comes out of this idea of making stills of how we're changing the planet, but that let the film also kind of extend that and to add context to that. So they're both the films are kind of slow moving, you know, they're contemplative, kind of, and they're very much like the photographs, that they leave you in a place that it doesn't provide any answers, but it sure allows for inflection points, and allows for you know, people to reach their own conclusions about what it is that they're seeing and what does it mean. And different people will find different meaning in it. And I think the role of art isn't, you know, necessarily to, at least for me, I don't want it to be didactic. I don't want it to be formulaic. I just want it to be something that allows you to enter a space and to be able to consider it in a new way. And I think we're trying to do that with film as well, and not following the kind of polemic or supporting an argument through a whole documentary, you know, and getting talking heads to support all the arguments. And we're letting complexity exist, you know, that there's different ways to interpret what you're looking at. And I think that's an interesting way to bring people to these ideas. Mostly it's still my art. For this film, there's been some individuals and some corporate support, and also government support. Once we had raised some of the key funding, we were able to tap into some different sources of money through tax credits and things of that nature. So it's a combination of everything, you know, to do a film, because they're expensive. And and even when you look at a successful documentary, I mean, Manufactured Landscapes was considered one of the top, you know, theatrical grossing movies after The Corporation at the time. I don't know if anything's beat it since, but it didn't recover. It didn't, you know, so it's the second most successful, but it never recovered. You know, nothing came back to the people who created it. You know, so it's kind of like, you know, so that's a success story, and it never, you know, so it's a, you know, in a way, you know, you get paid for making it, and then the residuals are rarely ever enjoyed, you know. So it's a tough, you know, I think people like film, of course they like film and they like documentaries, but the funding models are very, very difficult, and I, in a way, I wish documentaries were as popular as blockbusters, but because these are things that actually, you know, I think mean things in our world, that there's consequences, and, you know, are we fiddling and watching these silly, you know, blow up movies, you know, while Rome's burning, you know, it's kind of it is shocking that these things aren't more present as important, you know, ways of conveying and communicating what we're doing to the planet, and why, you know, what things we better watch out for, because they're coming, and so it seems to be an odd period where you know, social media and, you know, reality TV and the kind of plethora of you know, pretty serious dreck on TV, and it's kind of like, well, there's quality out there too, but it seems to have a much harder time to get out into the world. Maybe it's always been that way, I don't know. I've had the oil sands appear in all of my books almost. That I'm always referencing the oil sands as a kind of, I mean, one of the things that a lot of people sometimes don't understand in my work, because somebody says, oh, these are disasters, and I'm going, I don't do disaster photography. The closest I've come to it is the oil spill, but that was oil and water coming together in this, it was an industrial accident or misjudgment, but that's the closest I've come to photographing a disaster. What I photograph are totally conscious, intentional landscapes. These are the places that we have taken the things that we need from nature. So it's, you can call it a disaster, but you can't make an omelet without breaking an egg. You know, it's like, so this is the broken egg. You know, so here's the omelet, the city, but it takes a lot of stuff out there to make that city. What's the equivalence of that? What's the scale of that in nature? You know, so to me, these are human systems imposed on a landscape to provide for urban expansion and 7 billion and growing population. So if it's a disaster, it's of our own conscious making. You know, it's not an accident. We're making this. We're giving the rights to allow people to go in and access what they need in that landscape and profit from it. And it has a destructive quality to it. As in any act of creation, there's an equal or greater act of destruction. It's just we tend not to look at the act of destruction for the act of creation. We just focus on the creation. And so that's where I think my work and these films that Jennifer and I have worked on are counterpoints to that, just looking at the end result of all that stuff and being drawn, you know, by the glittering lights and the towers and the seductive, you know, beauty of life in the 21st century. There's a price. There's another side of that equation that nobody cares to look at. So I think that seems to be what I've been sent here to kind of point out, that there's another side to this equation.